At the end of the last lecture, we derived GLU look-at transformation in order to place objects in the 3D world for a given camera. In this lecture, we are going to talk about the GLU perspective transformation, which transforms the 3D world appropriately to place objects onto the screen. The entire transformation pipeline will include first a GLU look-at or equivalent camera transformation, and then the viewing or the projection transformation. Let's go back to the projection tutorial. We'll notice here that GLU perspective has four commands. GLU lookat below has eye, center, and up. We already saw this. And again, you can increase the field of view. You can play with the aspect ratio. You can change the near clipping plane. You can change the far clipping plane. So what are all of these different variables and how do they affect the GLU perspective matrix? Fundamentally, we have a viewing frustum in GLU perspective. Remember that in GL ortho, this was just a cuboid because objects, they stay in the same location regardless of depth, the size remains the same. However, for perspective projection, further away objects become smaller. And so what you really have is a viewing frustum. So we can think of this as being the eye, and you can complete the frustum this way. But any object that lies below the near plane, you block out. And similarly, any object that lies beyond the far plane, you block out. That's why you're specifying the near plane and the far plane, and that's why you have a frustum. The next parameter is the field of view, and that's fairly obviously defined. In fact, it's the field of view in the y direction because the x and y field of views could actually be different. And you have a screen which has some width and some height. The aspect ratio is the ratio of width to height. We're not going to talk very much about it, but it does need to be considered in deriving the appropriate formula. The GLU perspective command takes in a field of view in the y direction, the aspect ratio, and positive values for z near and z far. So although you're looking down the minus z axis, these are distances that are positive. So the field of view and the aspect ratio control the field of view in the x and y directions, and z near and z far control the viewing frustum. Here is the overhead view of our screen again, and we will be interested in computing the quantities theta and d. This quantity is theta, and this is given simply by the field of view in the y direction divided by 2. So the total field of view is 2 theta. So this quantity theta we can write as the field of view y divided by 2. Very simple. What is d equal to? Just from the geometry of the situation, we want to map things again onto the unit cube. So this is one unit. And from trigonometry, we know that tan theta is equal to 1 over d, which means d must be equal to cotangent of theta. So d we'll write as cot theta. I've just noted that down again here on the slide. We now need to find the matrix corresponding to this. And I've written it down in the simplest form. The minus 1 by d here corresponds to the perspective transformation. So this is just your standard perspective 1 over z transformation. And this is the what requires that the z-coordinate divide by d, and so you get smaller the further away you are. Finally, the aspect ratio is taken into account here, and in this way you can handle different aspect ratios. Since we are in homogeneous coordinates, you can multiply all of this by a constant factor without affecting the matrix, and therefore you just multiply the whole thing by d. In this way, this becomes minus 1, and the other coordinates change accordingly. So we have d by aspect. This becomes d. And here, I've written these as a and b because we are going to play with this lower 2 by 2 matrix in order to get the near and far planes to map properly. This is all that is required to get z to map properly, so we don't care about x and y. We only care about z and w for the mapping of the near and far planes, which we'll get to next. Normally, when I talk about homogeneous coordinates, I say it's a four vector, x, y, z, and w. However, you can also add a homogeneous coordinate to a single coordinate, z in this case, and so for simplicity, I've just written z and w. I've omitted x and y because we've already found the matrix form for them and they're not affected by this mapping.
So this is, I'll just write down, this is the w coordinate.
So let's see what happens here. I will get a, z plus b, and this will be minus z. Note that this is still in homogeneous coordinates, so if I have to dehomogenize, I have to divide by this minus z, and I'll get minus a minus b over z. So I've just noted that down here. And now we have a system of simultaneous equations that we have to place to consider the near and far planes at the appropriate location. When z is equal to minus n, remember that we are looking down the minus z axis, we want this quantity to go to minus 1 because we're mapping to the unit cube. And when z is equal to minus f, you want this quantity to go to plus 1 because, again, we're mapping from minus 1 to plus 1. So z is equal to minus n, I put minus n in here, and therefore I have that minus a plus b by n is equal to minus 1. Now z is equal to minus f is plus 1, I put z is equal to minus f in here, and I get similarly an expression like this, minus a plus b by f is equal to plus 1. Here I have a system now of simultaneous equations for a and b, and so I can solve this. I can subtract these equations and I'll get a formula for b. I can appropriately scale and multiply them to get a formula for a. I won't go through the algebra here. You can work it out as an exercise. The important thing is to write down the simultaneous equations, which I just showed you, and eventually you get a formula like this. A is equal to minus f plus n, f minus n, b is minus 2fn by f minus n. That completes the derivation of the GLU perspective matrix. Indeed, in homework 2, you will be, in addition to using GLU lookat, you will also program in yourself the GLU perspective matrix. Finally, I want to do two things. First, I briefly want to discuss the nonlinear mapping in Z. And second, I want to show you a summary of the entire transformation pipeline in OpenGL, which in the last few lectures we have been getting to parts of. I first note that the mapping of Z is nonlinear, and I've written down again what happens to the Z and W coordinates, and when you dehomogenize, you get minus A minus B by Z. The nonlinear mapping has it proportional to 1 over Z. This nonlinear mapping is interesting. Of course, in principle, you don't need to map it this way. And in fact, with the advent of programmable shaders, you could, in principle, take over the Z mapping to whatever you wanted. Some of the more ambitious of you might want to play around with that in homeworks 1 or 2. However, all of the mappings that have been proposed in the literature have these kinds of nonlinearities. And it has an advantage, which is that it handles a broad range of depths. 1 over infinity is 0, 1 over 100 is 0.01. They're very similar. You handle the full range. And so you can have depths from 10 centimeters to 100 meters. And in many computer graphics scenes, you do in fact have this range of depth. However, and this is a major challenge, the depth resolution is not uniform. The depth is intended to be the maximum near the near clipping plane. And for those of you who can follow along with this, one quick way of seeing this is if you differentiate this, this corresponds to depth resolution, it will be proportional to 1 by z square. And of course, 1 by z square is small near the near clipping plane and rapidly degrades as you get further away. So one common mistake that people write in writing their programs is to set the near clipping plane to 0, the far clipping plane to infinity. You say, I don't want to deal with the frustum. I'm perfectly happy considering all objects. This is a problem. And in fact, if we'll show in a later lecture, I'll show actually programming this in and how it leads to garbage. Because all of the depth resolution then is at 0. And in fact, for an object at any positive depth value, you will have 0 resolution. When you have limited resolution, all objects go into the same depth bin, because in practice, you have a finite quantization in the depth buffer. And therefore, effectively, you can't resolve depths. So therefore, do not set your near clipping plane to 0. With the far clipping plane, you have much more flexibility because it goes as 1 over z. So 1 over infinity or 1 over 10,000 doesn't really make much difference. But the near clipping plane is more sensitive and it should actually be set to where the geometry in the scene is. Let me finally summarize the whole viewing pipeline. I acknowledge Greg Humphreys for originally providing this slide. You start in model coordinates over here, and then you apply a transformation to the model. This is scale, translation, rotation, so 4x4. You eventually get to world coordinates. Then you apply the camera transformation GLU lookat, which is what we ended the last sequence of lecture segments with. Now you have things in what are known as I coordinates. So far, for just projecting geometry, the distinction of each of these individual stages, model, world, I, is not important because you concatenate the transformations together. But one of the critical things is lighting, which we'll talk about in a few lectures from now. That is performed in I coordinates. So lighting is performed in I coordinates. That's important because lighting is a 3D concept and you don't project the scene before you perform lighting. Okay, so this highlighted region is the perspective transformation, GLU perspective, which is what this lecture has been about. And once you go through the GLU perspective transformation, so remember that you will apply GLU perspective to the results of GLU lookat. The net transformation matrix will be the projection matrix times what's known as the model view matrix, or GLU perspective times GLU lookat. Then you go into screen coordinates, so you're in what's also known as normalized device coordinates. It goes from -1 to +1, it's a cube. After that, you have to go to the viewport transformation, which goes to the actual window you're considering. And finally, you go to the device coordinates. These two steps we don't talk about very much, but notice that if you look at the programs, they will have a GL viewport command. And essentially, once you're in the unit cube, you still have to get to the appropriate location in your screen and position the window appropriately on your monitor. And that's what these two things deal with. As far as this lecture has been concerned, the past two lectures have dealt with the model transformation and the camera transformation. This lecture has dealt with perspective. And all of these come together in the viewing pipeline.